This episode of the Red and White Podcast is brought to you by Will Sossaman, commercial real estate advisor at Phoenix Commercial Properties right here in Raleigh. Will is a huge Wolfpack fan and NC State alumni whose passion is helping buyers, sellers, landlords, and tenants find clear strategic solutions for their property needs. If you're thinking about leasing, buying, selling, or even investing in commercial real estate, you need a local professional with superior market knowledge on your side. Give Will a call, 919-632-6953. And I'll link his email address in the description of this podcast. Remember that when it comes to commercial real estate, where there's a will, there's a way. Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. Apes that they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will. And there's a heated discussion going on right now in the pod chat that I might have just started with my comment that Devin Leary is not very good. I'm watching the UConn game back, and the first throw to Thayer Thomas scored on touchdown was severely underthrown. But the reason I said all that is because I went back and I was looking at the PFF grades. And Devin Leary scored a 56 PFF grade.
Yeah, he had a low QBR too, which is interesting because you like go back and look at the numbers. And it's pretty fine. I don't know, do you have the stats for the game?
His stats?
Yeah, just his raw ones.
Yeah, one sec.
Also, I don't care that the ball was underthrown.
You
got a better chance of catching an underthrown ball than an overthrown ball.
I thought I had his stats.
Look at that, man. How much do I have to vamp for you to pull up stats? Come on. Just fair warning to everyone listening, I've had a hefty pour of whiskey. I'm ready to rock and roll. It's Clemson week.
I'm going to pull the ESPN box score here.
So if I come hot into the mic too much.
32 of 44, 320, four touchdowns, interception, QBR of 56.
Yeah, like, say that again. 320, four touchdowns, one interception, and it's a 56?
Yeah.
What else are you supposed to do? What was his completion rate there? What was it?
His completion rate, 32 of 44.
So, like, 70%?
64%.
And that's a 56?
Yeah. His season QBR is 48.5. I don't know. The reason I started this debate, because I looked at his PFF score, and I'm thinking, what the hell, man? Like, I don't know. That was severely underthrown ball, but why haven't we hit any deep balls? It still blows my mind. And I don't think it's the cast, right? Everybody, the wide receivers are taking a beating. And I do think there is some issue with the wide receivers. I don't think it is all on the wide receivers, because we had this last year with him throwing jump balls to Emeka. Like, it's.
Yeah. Emeka's better than all these dudes that are still here. Like, here's the reason I think the cast is to blame. Not the cast, their skill set per se, but it's the rotation of the cast. Like, we're four games into the season, and probably last game, and I guess ECU, is probably a pretty good tell of who the actual starters that we're going to lean on are going to be, right? It's going to be Carter, Thayer, Lassane, Jones, and a little bit of Rooks. Like, there was hardly any time in there for Anthony Smith and Julian Gray. Which maybe for the Clemson game that makes sense, but honestly, I still am just not really seeing it. Like, the rotations are really still bothering me. And Lassane in particular, I do not feel like we're using him right. It just doesn't feel like we ever get him in the right positions. I don't care about the underthrow. I'd rather him underthrow balls than overthrow. Like, no joke, right? Like, we can't catch balls that are overthrown. And
I guess
I mean, he missed Thayer on a wide open route where he overthrew him, right? And if he underthrows him, okay, yeah, he doesn't get any yards after catch, but it's like a 25-yard route at that point. So, you know, that's where I think the rotations have really impacted his timing with everybody. Like, his timing with Thayer should be good, but I just think when you're constantly changing the cast out there in those first three games, really first two, or sorry, middle two, it's just going to be hard to really get a rhythm and get tempo with everybody. So I'm not surprised, but I mean, here's the thing. Like, if you're telling me a bad game is 64%+ and four touchdowns and an interception, whatever, dude, I'm taking it. I don't care. That's good enough with this defense in most games.
The bigger question is, and we've talked about this, right? The offensive explosiveness, like, yeah. What are we missing? I'm still trying to figure that out, right? Because I watched this game and it was fine. It was what we were expecting against UConn. There's nothing that I, you know, really can take away from this game about, you know, the overall team, but it still feels meh to me. I don't know. I don't know why.
I think a part of it is, again, the guys like your, like the UConn game, there's, and even the Texas Tech game, if you go back and look at that, right? Some of the deeper shots you take are like Texas Tech, we took shots to Lassane. In UConn, we took multiple deep shots to Thayer. Like, those aren't the guys that I'm thinking you should be doing that for, right? There were a couple where Thayer and Lassane can't get any separation on some of those shots, where I'm thinking, boy, Anthony Smith seems to get open on those. Like, I know everyone's like, oh, Anthony Smith drops them, but at least Anthony Smith is open so that if he doesn't drop it, he's got it in that basket and he's going. So, like, a lot of it, I think, is like, I just don't understand why we're using the personnel in certain ways. Maybe it's to be unpredictable, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, I guess. But, like, I just don't think we're running in an optimal way. And it's like, you know, what are you trying to be? Like, if you go back and watch the Clemson-Wake Forest game, it's like Wake Forest was totally happy to be taking one-on-one shots that are basically jump balls and hoping they get PI, and, you know, and then maybe they catch it, whatever. You know, it doesn't seem to be like our design, because it feels like if you go back throughout the whole season, it's like, I know Anthony Smith got grabbed against Charleston Southern, but like I'm having a hard time thinking of any time else this year that we got pass interference. Like, what causes that?
Yeah, you know, it jives with the history too, right? We've just not been a explosive vertical team. And I don't know. I keep watching these games waiting for it to change. I don't know why, but I am. And I saw this one and I was like, yeah.
I mean,
we're the same.
It's the way our scheme is built, right? Like, I was having to go like defend this crazy statement that I made today on IPS, where I basically implied that if I was a wide receiver recruit, I'd be more interested in playing in Wake Forest or Tennessee or Ohio State's offenses than NC State. Right? And the theory or the reasoning is, because look at the distribution of passes and the way that we attack teams. Like, I mean, right now, our top five, like, obviously it's a quarter of the way through the season. Everyone, we know this is limited sample size, but welcome to football. It's always going to be limited sample size. You know, right now, Thayer Thomas has 15 receptions for 217 yards. Devin Carter has 9 receptions for 117. Demi Sumo has 6 for 102. Jordan Houston has 6 for 82. Keon Lassane has 9 for 82. Like, it's not a good sign when two running backs are in your top five receiving 4 games in. And it's not like we've played against really strong competition at this point. You've had 2 gimme games, and you've had ECU, which is a tough game to open the season with, and Texas Tech. You know, so like, everyone's been saying this for years. You can go back and look at Philip Danford's charting in the passing game. You can listen to some of the podcasts out there. We throw the ball a lot to our running backs, you know, and just in general, passes to your running backs are not going to be large gainers by any mean. They're extensions of your run game. So it's going to kind of bring your explosiveness down in some ways because you're taking those targets away from wide receivers. And then you factor in that our wide receivers in general have always struggled with separation. You know, even the really good receivers in Kelvin Harmon and Jacoby Myers and Emeka Emezi really didn't often get much separation. They were often contested catches, 50-50 balls, like whatever. They caught them and they made the offense continue to convert and move the chains. But like we've been like a crazy third down conversion offense. And instead of being in third and short, a lot of times it's been third and long. And so, you know, it's just the product of the system we've run over multiple coordinators. We just don't have an explosive passing game. And in either that is because you have not gotten explosive wide receivers or you have not schemed an explosive passing game.
Yeah. And I think it's gotta be systematic. Like you said, it's been inconsistent over the years, but you know, the reason or the excuse rather that we had in the past was, you know, Ryan Finley can't throw the deep ball, right? That was that one. We shouldn't have that same conversation with Devin Leary, because obviously he's got the arm strength, but so it's got to be scheme related. I'd like somebody who is more well versed on the technicalities of football to answer this question, but I'm curious if it's speed or if it's route running or if it's schemes and route trees that get separation, right? Just saying we don't have the guys getting separation. Like you said, we have Anthony Smith and some other fast guys. Why are they not getting open?
I mean, doesn't it, like when you watch other games over like the last 4 years in particular, like there's certain quarterbacks that throw, I don't know what to call it, a moon ball, you know, a high arcing pass that then drops down in their wide receiver's breadbasket far down the field, and it's an easier catch and they run it in. And it seems like Devin Leary is throwing on a lower trajectory, much more power. And so, like, I don't think he gives his guys a lot of time to adjust to it. While some of these other teams with like inferior quarterbacks from like an arm talent perspective, I mean, just throw up those high parabolic balls. I don't know what to call them. That then just come down like straight down right into the receiver, and they either get a jump ball or you know, like Sam Hartman does it, Sam Howell did it, you know. But then there's other passes that they can't seem to make too. So like, I mean, it's a trade off, but it's just, to me, it's almost like, can Leary throw that kind of ball, you know, or is it that these other teams really just like practice it over and over? Are they just throwing to specific spots, for example? And they just know that, hey, I throw this ball with this much arc in it, this much speed, and it's going to come down relatively in this spot. And my dude's either going to jump up and get it or get pass interference, or maybe it gets broken up. But like, it doesn't seem like those are intercepted a lot. I don't know. I just haven't really seen Leary throw that kind of ball. So and neither did Finley either. So I just wonder if it's just something that's just a skill set. Some quarterbacks are really comfortable with it or not, and it can kind of really make up a lot of, I don't know, intangibles for wide receivers, because it kind of takes out the guessing out of the game for the quarterback and the wide receiver.
I know we have some football savants that listen to that, so hopefully somebody will get back to me with an answer there. I think there's a... I'm super curious.
You hear that, everyone? That. I'm not a savant.
No, that like hurts. Some real football, some football coaches, and some former players I know listen. You know, looking at PFF grades, two of our lowest of the year, or I'll just say our two lowest categories of all year have been passing on offense and tackling on defense. Kind of weird to me.
Wait. Okay, so they're saying we're not tackling very well?
Yeah. Missed tackles.
Fuck that. I'm sorry. Sorry, Mom. Whatever, dude. This defense looks good. They look look fine. I guess we'll find out against Clemson in a hurricane, but we look good tackling at this point. Good enough. Like, we're like top 10 nationally in defense. How much better could the tackling get? It's probably Tanner Engel's fault.
I'll get
into our little rocket.
I'll get into missed tackles and whatnot at another point, but I don't know. He's got 20 tackles. He's only four off the lead. Drake Thomas is 24 for the season. Pitt's 17, Fagan 16, Jalen Scott 14. Yeah.
Who's the top two again?
Drake Thomas, Tanner Engel.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, I don't know, man. It's like you go back and watch the Texas Tech game and you watch this game. It's like, is there really anything to complain about on defense? Like, really?
No, and I get it. Dave called out tackling. And that's, yeah. You know, the PFF grade kind of reflects that. I don't think they're a bad tackling team, but I do think they've missed some tackles and it'll get better.
I mean, they'll have a perfect opportunity in the next several games because they'll be facing a lot of more running quarterbacks and maybe an opportunity to tackle in space.
Yeah.
So maybe they can show off.
Going back to this UConn game for a few minutes. I'm just looking at and watching the game. I was kind of surprised to see this stood out to me when I look at these PFF grades. Michael Allen was the second highest graded player on the team. He graded out at 82.3. And I will be the first to admit that I thought he looked really good because I've been Michael Allen skeptic just based on his high school film and what we've seen of him. I thought he looked a little slow and I just didn't see it with the shuffle steps, but he looked legit. He looked quick. He had seemed to have good vision, find the holes. Like I'm surprised he's not on the field more already.
Yeah.
And I know they're probably using for the four games and redshirt him, but man, he looked really good in limited reps there.
I think his high turnover footsteps are what throws you off. To me, I think that's going to lend to him being more balanced and able to cut and react. So I guess I was never really that concerned. To your last point, I don't think we should be thinking about redshirting guys that can run the ball well.
I agree.
Like, that's the one position that, like, I would think categorically everyone understands they're the most likely to leave as soon as possible to get to the NFL. So use them as much as you can. And so if he's ready, and if he can contribute in more than just, you know, I'd like to, I guess, maybe go back and see, like, is UConn still have their starters in at that point or not? Like, not like it really matters because it's UConn, but it'd be good to understand if, like, he was going against experienced bodies or not. But I mean, if he can contribute,
he's our leading rusher. Playing.
What'd you say?
He was our leading rusher, 10 for 66.
Yeah, but we only let Demi Suma run four times because...
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I get it. But he, you know, he looked good.
I guess what I'm saying is there's no point in protecting a guy and holding him for four games. Like, if he can give you good runs, better than Mims or Delbert, whatever. DeMarcus Jones, jeez. We've got too many Delberts and Ds. Got a Demi, a Delbert, a DeMarcus.
Devin, Dylan, Daryl, Devin.
Man.
Derek.
We're all about that D.
Devin.
Yeah, so I would say just freaking play him if he can play, man. It was good to see some fresh legs out there.
He looked real good.
Yeah, I agree.
Other high grades, I'll reach the top 10. Thayer, Michael Allen, Timothy McKay, who got the start at right tackle. I mean, he's been playing real well this year.
Friend of the kinda pod.
Friend of the pod. Surprised. Yes, like the Boneyard guy. Friend of the pod. Timothy McKay, Demi Sumo, Delbert Mims, Devin Carter, Grant Gibson, Kellen Sane, DeMarcus Jones, Porter Rooks. Devin Carter seemed to be somewhat engaged in this game. Good thing to see.
Yeah, because we decided to finally throw at him. Like, the more I thought about it, like watching that Texas Tech game, and I remember seeing it in person and being like, why is he so pissed right now? And like, I totally get it now. Like, if after if after three games, like the team is still in the, we got to go throw it at everyone else, Devin, and I want you to just go run out there and just waste your time and energy. Like, I get if he was frustrated. Cause like we finally treated him like he was supposed to be part of the plan. Right? Like, it was noticeable that we were actually throwing the ball to him.
I mean, he and Port Rooks both got 5 receptions.
Port Rooks had some nice yards after the catch, too.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he looked like he was running hard. I mean, it was strong. I was trying to pull up his target numbers.
Rooks had his first career touchdown, which is ridiculous because he caught that touchdown against Virginia.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'll never forget that. That was egregious. I really liked seeing, here's the thing. Like if Devin Carter will just always act the way he did in that game, just constantly flexing and just in that energy mode.
Yeah.
Like he will be great all season. Like sometimes I don't know if he just kind of loses that energy somewhat, but when it's there, it's great. And I love seeing it. Cause like, frankly, like the whole wide receiver core has acted like couldn't care less at times, it seemed. So at least he showed like some passion out there.
5 receptions on 6 targets. So exactly what we talked about last week. He was inefficient and disengaged. Looked like he got it back.
Yeah.
Good for him.
He watched how Stella got her groove back and he was like, this is it. This is how I do it.
Yeah. Any other takeaways for that game before we move on?
Oh, can we talk about the fake field goal?
Oh, I guess we got to talk about the stupid fake field goal. Would you have kicked a fake field goal against UConn?
I would have kicked the field goal is what I would have done. Yeah. I wouldn't have. I mean, like, I'm just sorry. I just I'm not going to take someone who has had an injury history. I don't care if the injury is because of tackles or because of kicking. I would not have asked them to try to run that kick there. My other problem with it is, if your argument is I did it because people have been rushing us like crazy and coming off the edge, then okay. How come when you ran it, UConn wasn't coming off the edge at all? And by the way, the previous kick, they weren't coming off the edge like that either.
Yeah.
Like to me, run it when they're doing that and penalize them for it. Like do it in the 3 previous games when people are doing that. That's what really annoys me is just it came across as Dave Dorn really just for whatever reason was like, I should go run a fake field goal for some reason. So I'm going to go do it. And I'm sure part of my mindset was UConn sucks. And I'm sure our kicker can either get the first down or get a touchdown. So who cares? Let's roll it. And then they literally ran it into the waiting arms of UConn, which tells me that they didn't do their research. They didn't think about it. They just arbitrarily decided to call the play. So it was a really, really dumb play. And I really hope that Chris Dunn is not injured for a monumentally stupid play when you're up 30 points already. Like, that's the other factor. You're up so many points. Why would you do this? Like, hey, guess what? Like, fake field goals, like, they don't work all the time. If they worked all the time, people would run them more often. There's a whole reason why you don't see fake field goals that often. And to do it in a freaking meaningless game in a meaningless situation, just so dumb. Like,
but Will, we have to put it on tape.
That I don't understand. That's insane. No one's going to, guess what? Everyone's going to go try to block your field goals because your kicker can't even get 3 yards running the ball. Like, oh yeah, I'm sure that's going to really scare Clemson or FSU. It's just crazy. That was when he said that, I was like, you might as well have just said, Dave, that I just figured UConn sucked. Because who's going to go be like, oh, you know what we got to worry about? Dave's so unpredictable. He's beating the crap out of a team. He might kick a field goal. Oh, or maybe he won't. Please. Please.
I thought the whole thing was strange from the timing, from the execution, from his post-game comments. I love Salty Dave. I thought that was a weird place for him to be. Why are you asking me about injuries? Right? I mean, Chris Dunn came up and he's grabbing his back, his hip area, you know, clearly not okay. And yeah, the the reporters actually did their job for once and asked a relevant question. And he kind of blew it off like, we just beat UConn by 30. Why are you asking me about injuries? Well, you know, you got Clemson next week and you know the kicking history. If you're going to run it with your backup, run it with somebody else. Put Anthony Smith in there, right? I mean, like, see if they're paying attention.
Yeah. Like, things like, you're supposed to beat the crap out of UConn. Like, nothing about that game was impressive, Dave. Like, that's why I knew, like, something was up. Because him getting all self-defensive in that moment of, oh, I can't believe you're bringing up injuries after a game like that. It's like, well, that game was boring, Dave.
Game was like, really boring.
You beat the crap out of a really bad team that's gotten the crap kicked out of it 3 of the last 4 weeks. Like, there's nothing impressive in what you just did. You know, like, I'm sorry that everyone is curious about a very important part of your team clearly looking hurt. You know, clearly interested in Demi Sumo, the star running back this year, coming out a little hobbled. Devin Leary taking a lot of shots unnecessarily in the fourth quarter against a team that you're dominating on because you wanted to score again? Like, why? Who cares? Just take the W and get out of there, man. Like, it's stuff like that where I just go, man, like, this staff is just so clueless sometimes. Like, I don't know how you can be so good at your job to consistently win and then do stuff like that. Like, it kind of explains why we probably haven't gotten over the hump that we should get over with the staff. Because it's like they just do stupid things like that. Think about the long term. Like, what if any of those players are out for 1 game, 2 games, 4 games against UConn? That's so frustrating. And if I was a reporter, I would be like asshole in that interview with him and be like, I'll tell you why we're asking, Dave. Because there's a lot on the line. This is supposed to be an important year. And you just threw dudes out there, I guess just because you wanted to either reward them or reward yourselves, when you didn't need to. You could have been playing the freaking backups from the second quarter on. Just drives me nuts, man.
That is... I don't often agree with Ethan from IPS. I don't often agree with his takes, but he had one on their post-game pod where...
It was a good point.
It was a real good point. You got Devin Leary in there playing with the second team guys. Why, you know, last week you were talking about chemistry. They need to build chemistry with Devin and Porter and the other guys. Why is Devin Leary in there with second team guys so deep into this game? I thought that was really weird.
Why is he throwing to Jalen Coit, I think is the way he phrased it. And I was like, amen, man. Amen. Yeah. Like, why are backup?
He's getting again, weird crushed. Decisions, right? It's just there's a couple of them that I just thought were kind of perplexing. I wouldn't have run that fake. I wouldn't have run it with a hurt kicker. I would have gotten MJ Morris more reps. I mean, just all these things. Like, that game was boring as hell. There was no flow to it late. They put in Jack Chambers, which is probably another discussion. And I don't know. It was the whole thing was kind of weird.
I would have put
kind of left a sour taste in my mouth after watching it.
Yeah. If you really want to run a fake to put it on tape, I would have put Colin Smith in and I would have let him kick a field goal. Kick it, put it through the uprights, put it not through the uprights, doesn't matter. Then run the fake on the next one. Right. You know what I mean? Like, make it look like you're trying to see what your kicker can do, and then you're like, hey, I didn't appreciate how they were trying to block my backup kicker, so I want to put this on tape. Like, again, I think what frustrates me is when I went back and just looked at those kicks quickly throughout the game, they weren't coming off the edge the way he was talking about.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it was just a weird justification.
Breaking news, Coolio just died.
Why can't this year give me a break?
Coolio, you know, died.
I'm already having a tough time with our family, and now Coolio? Unbelievable. Just unbelievable. Hold on a second.
I do hope it was a fantastic voyage.
Coolio is dead. Yeah. Can you believe it? Coolio. Oh, I got to go back and record. That's how you know we do this live.
Breaking news. That's right.
Jeez. Good grief, man. Lost my train of thought.
We're going with this. Oh, all right. The other one that IPS and others have been pushing this week is given the state of the weather. And I'm going to first say a disclaimer. I have no idea what this hurricane is going to do. I don't know what this game is going to do. And I don't think anybody else does too. Everybody's weather app is wrong. All their weather apps are stupid. They don't know until the last possible second. Stop comparing weather apps. Like, it doesn't matter. We don't know what's going to happen. We've seen these things happen, take dramatic shifts. Let's not pretend like we know what's going to happen. But that bearing in mind, we do know it's probably going to rain. It's probably going to be windy. And so people are suggesting, let's throw Jack Chambers in there. Make him a healthy part of this game plan. How do you feel about that? How do you feel about going into the most important game in forever with Jack Chambers, your backup quarterback, as a key piece of your game plan, or however it was phrased?
Well, you know, I'm not going to lie and say that I didn't think over the last few days that if we had another Notre Dame hurricane type game, that it would benefit Clemson more because they at least have Shipley and DJ to just run and pound it on the ground and try to be kind of multiple from that, where, you know, Devin Leary is not going to be really a part of the run game. And so it's not that I wasn't thinking about it, but at the same time, like, I think the weather would have to be pretty, pretty bad to have to be thinking that that should be a part of the game plan. And even if the weather was bad, I'd like to, like, see a series or two, I guess, of Devin out there trying to throw, because, like, I don't know. There's been a lot of, maybe I haven't paid attention to him as much as I think I have, but there's been a lot of really, really bad weather NFL games that I've seen, and, like, you can still semi-pass the ball. A lot of short routes, intermediate stuff. And I would much more trust my current quarterback to handle 10 yards and in type routes in really bad weather than Jack Chambers at this time. And, like, my other concern is, so far, when Jack Chambers has been in the game, I haven't seen anything to suggest that, you know, and probably because they're hiding the playbook, which is fine. But, like, even when he's scrambling and trying to make something of nothing, like, he's got like 7 yards in the crap time that he's played in. So I haven't seen anything that suggests that, like, oh yeah, the weather's really bad, let's just go to the running quarterback. Like, I get the concept. I just don't know if that makes sense yet. Now, would I be shocked if we had some packages where we put him in the game and let him do that? Sure. That's what we do with Jalen McClendon. Like, everyone says that, like, oh, Jalen McClendon was in that Notre Dame game all this time. It's like, he was actually in there for, like, pretty limited amount of times. Like, it was situational, and, you know, in the end, that game was won because of defensive special teams. So I just think it's kind of I don't know. It's not crazy to think it, but it's just kind of, I don't know. There's just not enough data to suggest. Like, he's not a power runner. Like, and if the weather's that bad, is he going to be a factor? Like, I don't know.
Wouldn't you just go Wildcat, though? Like, if
that's what I would say.
Yeah, like, yeah. Just put Demi back there and Michael Allen and let him go. But what are we worried
Jordan
about?
Jordan Houston and Demi. Yeah. Like, yeah. Here's the thing. Like, you know.
There.
The other thing someone was, like, saying, maybe someone mentioned it, but it's like, Jeff Chambers hasn't been taking on a bunch of snaps, right? Like, you know, so there is that factor of like, it's wet, it's awful. Like, maybe the quarterback that's been taking the majority of the snaps should also be in the game, just from that perspective. I mean, yeah. Maybe they could be practicing under center. Like, look, if they were going to go, okay, here's the thing. If they were going to do it and they were going to just run like triple option stuff, like just completely change the playbook, yes, I will say then let's go for it. Let's get weird. Let's get wild. But like, to me, Devin Leary's got a hell of an arm. Like, I would just really, me, I'd spread the field out and I would tell my receivers to just go run verticals and I'm just going to heave the ball up. And we just saw Clemson literally PI like 15 times against Wake Forest. Why wouldn't you do that? It doesn't matter if the weather sucks and the ball's not going to be catchable. If the official has to sit there and watch Clemson guys draping all over Ant Smith, Porter Rooks, Julian Gray, whoever, that's better anyways. You know, and if they're not going to call it, then whatever. We'll change at that point. But, like, no, I don't think he should be like, you don't trot Jack Chambers out there right away. You know, unless he's like the second coming and we've just been hiding it.
Yeah, I think that's, I don't know. I just heard that and I'm just like, yeah, let's not do this. Let's not go there with that. Like, I don't want the ball in Jack Chambers' hands when he just hasn't, he's just unproven that situation. Like, I'm going to ride with Devin Leary. As much as I've been riding Devin Leary about being bad this year, I think he can. I trust him more to throw screen passes and slants and the stuff we're going to do, and just in general control the ball and control the game more than Jack Chambers in that situation. I mean, it's your biggest game in however long, however you want to define it. Like, why are you going to? It just seems crazy to me. Seems crazy to me to put that, you know, to think that's going to be a reality. Yeah, I don't know. I just thought it was something we should address. How are you feeling about this game in general? Like, let's assume the weather is going to be manageable, rainy and windy like a normal day. Who does that play? Who does that favor? Does that favor Clemson? Does that favor State?
I mean, if everyone's going to be relatively conservative and maybe just doing some RPO type stuff, like, I don't know. Both of these defenses are good. I think ours is better right now, just based on what we saw Clemson versus Wake. It's, you know, someone was asking Dabo about, I can't believe I just said Dabo. I've always said Dabo. They asked Dabo about like three or four of the guys that are injured right now and whether or not they're going to play and maybe that would impact things. We've got experience playing a hurricane. They've got experience playing a hurricane. It's at home. They at least have a mobile quarterback. Like, they should win in that factor, but it's going to be wet. Turnovers are weird. We've been good on special teams. Like, maybe that favors us instead. But who knows? Do we have our kicker? They probably have theirs. Their guy, like, at least from listening to the broadcast of the Wake game, their kicker seems to be a well-known commodity. So if I have to try it out, our backup kicker versus theirs in this kind of game, and it's not 40-mile-per-hour winds, then like, I'm probably going to favor them. They have like one of the longest home winning streaks out there. Like, so that favors them. So, like, I don't think we should win, but I think I just wish it was going to be like dry, perfect atmosphere, right? And we could see if like we've really been like dialing everything back just for this game. I don't know. I could just easily see us like having a couple pick sixes or fumble recoveries. And I don't know. This game could be like 14-12.
I fully expected to be something stupid. I guess my thought process has been, if it's windy and wet and it's hard to throw, I feel like that benefits us. But at the same time, I like us to be able to force DJU to throw. I feel like our secondary is probably one of the better secondaries they're going to face. And it kind of plays into our favor. But at the same time, our run defense is also pretty damn good and probably our strong suit. So, you know, maybe keeping them more one-dimensional and just worrying about DJ running it. I don't know. I keep going back and forth on who is this benefit. I think for us, we can throw screens and slants and, you know, the quick passes that we're going to do in kind of rainy weather. Is Clemson going to be able to throw their, you know, they threw a bunch of, you know, middle deep stuff against Wake, even there in their overtime plays where DJU making plays, just running around, their guys running in the back of the end zone. I can't decide who benefits more from this weather.
I mean, if they're going to run the whole time, like, I mean, look, they're number 8 rush defense, we're number 10. Like, so to me, it's just going to come down to like who generates turnovers. And so let me see if we've got a quick turnover. We'll just call it turnover gained. We'll see whose name pops up first. We're tied for 13th and they're tied for 36th. 7 versus, let's see where state is, 9. Let's check turnover margin just in case. Like, I'm a little nervous because Houston and Sumo have fumbled a couple times this year, right? That doesn't make me super confident. You know, I think they're ahead of us in turnover margin if I'm scanning this really fast. So, I mean, it's just going to be a dumb luck game is my guess. You know, if it ends up being like that, it's like, you know, rainy and the weather is like 5 to 10 mile per hour winds, right? That's probably relatively even for us at that point. Like they haven't really looked explosive on offense. Like the Wake game watching, it was a lot of DJ making, you know, throwing up some balls and wide receivers just miraculously being there. And I think we are a much better defense than Wake Forest. So I don't know, man. I could see us win this game. Or I could see us lose by like a couple points. I don't think we're getting blown out, you know, unless the offense just never shows up.
I think it could be something sloppy. Like I just, even with the weather, I think it's going to be one of those weird games. I feel like Clemson fans and their team is, and this is going to sound weird to say, but I feel like they're scared. They're talking unnecessarily amounts of trash for a team they don't care anything about. And I don't know. I feel like they know we're good. And I'm not saying we're good. We're going to win good because, you know, it's a road game going into their environment, blah, blah, blah. But we're damn good. And I think they know that.
Yeah, it's weird how, like, up in their feels we are.
Really? Like, they're chirping at us, and it feels like, to me, it feels good. I'm like, I'm just taking it back and kind of enjoying this because, you know, the underdog, they're the team with everything to lose. And, you know, while it's a huge game for us and State's got everything to prove, I feel like all the pressure's on them. And I think that's why they're chirpy. I don't know.
Yeah. I think all I want to see from this game is to treat them like the same old Clemson.
Yeah.
They've stolen all your signals. They've tried to copy all your plays down so that the second you call something in, they can relay it in. They don't have Brent Venables anymore, but I would treat them like they do. And I would just have someone run the call in, especially if it's as bad as weather is. Have someone run the call in every time. Take that away from them, pop out, and go. They're going to be sloppy. They're going to be jumpy. I think they're going to be on edge because of how they played against Wake Forest. So, like, honestly, like, we should play like we're an underdog. And we should, like, just push it wherever we can push it. Don't play afraid. Don't worry about the weather. Like, be aggressive. Like, I don't think you can win this game just being like we're going to run it the whole time.
Yeah, their defense is still pretty good. Yeah. You know, judging by that Wake Forest game, their secondary is not very good. And but you know, I don't know how much that benefits us given our struggles throwing the ball and the weather. Like, it's a bad combination. So does it let them hide their poor secondary?
Oh,
maybe. It's kind of interesting to me. I'm kind of on the fence. I'm just enjoying it though, right? It's State's top 10 for the first time ever, and you know this hurricane coming in, but it's huge primetime exposure.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's probably gonna be like everyone's gonna be watching it in some ways because it's gonna be so gross. Like, people probably won't be able to turn away.
Yeah, and they're not, you know, people aren't gonna be out in the Southeast. People are gonna be inside. It's gonna be raining. You'll be watching football. You got game day. I don't know what game day is gonna do. And then they, you know, ESPN announced a new Pat McAfee show, which he's got a huge audience of his own. So it's even more exposure. I don't know, man. I think it's awesome, right? It feels really good to be in this position for once.
Yeah, I just looked, right? Like, the top 25 games that day, the only game that's going to be counter-programming to us is Georgia-Missouri.
Yeah.
Then you got Pitt, Georgia Tech, and way late USC and Arizona State. So, like, honestly, like, it basically will be all eyes on us from a top 25 perspective. So, you know, that's what I'm saying. Like, just go out and have fun, man. Like, this would be an opportunity, like, just push the limits. You don't have to be crazy like Brian Kelly was.
Right.
But, like, don't be a coward out there, you know, unless they think that DJ is going to make a ton of mistakes. Like, I don't know. There's like a part of me just watching that Wake Forest game and it's like, Wake should have won that game. You know, there was some pretty extremely clutch plays that DJ made in particular that I don't think he can kind of keep making all season, especially not against a better defense. So, I mean, Tony Gibson looked like he was like licking his chops thinking about
this game. Dude, the Tony Gibson presser was my favorite. He's like, I was watching it and he's talking about how good DJU is, and he's saying it with like a sly smile, like he knows, like, we're going to pick this son of a bitch off six times. Like, it just, I don't know. There's something about his face, like, and how he was speaking. I was just like, man, that dude's confident right now.
I just, you know, wish our offense had that confidence.
Yeah, right. Seriously.
Like, I don't even care if they would make mistakes. If they, like, literally came out and said, like, yeah, we're going to, quote, unquote, take what you give us, but we're also going to take what we want.
That'd be awesome.
That would be my presser speech if I was a head coach getting hired. That's what I would say. Almost as good as Wisconsin Oregon's baby.
Oh, still waiting for that baby. Damn stork. I'm going to play this call from Ed. Ed from LA is in the house. Hey, guys.
How you doing? It's Ed from you know where. Got some thoughts about this week's game. I don't think we learned anything last week against UConn, except thank goodness nobody got injured. Honestly, I don't think we're going to win this game. I am not sold on NC State's offense being able to rip the throat out of an opponent. If State had beaten ECU with those inside the 1 yard line drives and scored TDs on both of them and won the game 35-20, I would be picking State. I do not believe we will beat Clemson. They're used to the bright lights, the big stage, the ESPN College Game Day. They're used to all that. It doesn't faze them. But I will tell you this. There's a guy on the Pac Pride poster board that said, stop Shipley, make the quarterback beat us, and run the ball with some play action. I think that is the way to keep it close. So go Pack. Don't think we're going to win. I think Clemson wins. Bye.
This is devastating news that Ed from LA is on the Pac Pride boards.
I think he's just trolling. I think he's just reading. I think he's, you know, he's skeptical. I get it. A lot of State fans are. It is a big moment for us. But again, I think all the pressure is on Clemson. Everybody's expecting Clemson to win the ACC. Everybody expected Clemson to go to the playoff. Clemson's top five. Clemson's favorite. All the pressure is on Clemson. And I hope our team and our coaches are, you know, perpetuating that message through you know, everywhere, just saying, hey, you know, guys, we are, let's go have fun. Let's go play with our backs against the wall. And this is what I always said. Hey, I want to be Utah. Utah always seems to come through in these moments. So whatever Whittingham's doing at Utah, like, he gets it. He gets those guys
hands in the Mormon
the way he should. hands in the book. Like, he gets those guys playing the way they should be in this situation. And I hope we get some of that. I know the apprehension a lot of state fans have right now being, you know, being good. And we've talked about it. It's okay to be good. It's okay to feel confident. But I know there's some apprehension going into this game. But all the pressure's on Clemson. There's no pressure on us.
Yeah. What annoys me is this weird, like, I saw this earlier today and I was going to make a big deal about it. I was like, oh, we're probably podcasting, so we'll talk about it then. But, like, there was a segment on ESPN today with, like, I don't know why Paul Feinbaum is being asked about the ACC, but Paul Feinbaum and Heather Dinich are on there and they're talking about what it means if Clemson loses this game. And they were like, oh, it's terrible news for Clemson. And Heather Dinich was like, oh, well, they would be hanging from a cliff as far as the playoff is concerned. And not one of them said, like, well, I guess if they lose, it means top 10 NC State is maybe one of the best teams in the country. And maybe they should be in the playoff contention. So there's a part of me that, just beyond being a fan for NC State, really hopes we win this game so that we can just disrupt this crazy narrative right now that basically says that you just have to shoe in, you know, Georgia, Alabama, Ohio State, and Michigan as the top four teams. Like, I haven't seen anything from Michigan that's actually impressive. They haven't actually beat anyone worth a shit. So, like, if we win this weekend, like, we better be talked about as a top four team because no one else has that on their resume. No one has a big win.
On the road, let alone.
On the road. Yeah. Exactly. In a terrible game, terrible weather. And you know what? We'd get to go right back next week and play FSU, who will either be 4-0 or whatever they're going to be. I guess 4-0 or 5-0. I can't remember where they are in their schedule because they're playing Wake Forest this weekend. And if they play and we beat them too, it's like, all right, what else do you need to get? You guys need to see? Like, an ACC team is out here trucking teams. Give them the reward.
Like, but Will, you needed a missed field goal to beat ECU. Like, that's what everybody is. That's so everybody's what? Entire argument.
Texas should have beat Alabama. Like, if Texas had their players, Alabama would have lost. Like, yeah. Alabama doesn't look that special right now. Like, thanks a lot, Bill O'Brien. You're finally turning out to be who we thought you were.
We want, like, Bama.
You know, I don't want to hear it. Hey, Georgia barely beat Kent State. You know, maybe they're not number one. I'm joking, but like, you know what? Like, who cares? Week one, who else played like a really hard in-state rival on week one and had a tougher game than they expected? Who cares? If we go out and beat Clemson, I don't care. I don't think USC has done anything that special. Kentucky hasn't done anything that's really special. Oh, you beat Florida? Yeah, guess what? Florida sucks, okay? You know? Who else is in there? Oklahoma State? Get out of here. If we win this game, we should be number five minimum.
I agree. Should take their spot. I agree with you on Michigan. I think they're good.
And then you just got to hold out. Got to hold out until the College Football Playoff Committee comes around because, you know, Boo Corrigan, if you got a number five NC State team in the AP polls, I mean, that dude better be working the system than to get us ahead of Michigan. Like, Michigan, please. Come on. Jim Harbaugh's a has-been. College football playoff wants new blood.
All right. I got a couple questions here from some people. I've been saving them. It was asked last week. Rank these coaches who you think is the best. There's a bunch of job openings right now.
Jeff Collins, Scott Frost. Oh.
All the way around. Rank these coaches. Jamie Chadwell, Mike Elko, Sean Clark, Dave Clawson, Mike Houston. That's a tough list.
Well, I don't even know who Sean Clark is. So,
App State coach.
Okay. Jamie Chadwell.
Let me say something while you're thinking about this. App State, somebody had brought this up earlier. At least brought up Sean Clark earlier. He's a product of a program. That program, since Jerry Moore, has been good. Everybody who's been in there has won to some level. Drink, Satterfield, Sean Clark. And App State should have lost. They should be 1-3 right now. So there's that. I'm going to put him at the bottom of the list for you. Go ahead.
Hey, Evan, he's beat Texas A&M and we haven't. Okay. Yeah,
on the road. I get it.
Actually, let me revise this. I think Dave Clawson is the best on this list. Then I'd put Jamie Chadwell. Give me my other three names, Mike Elko, Sean Clark, and who was the fifth one?
Mike Houston, ECU coach.
Yeah. Oof. Then I'd say Mike Houston. Then I'd say, how long has Sean Clark been at App State?
Since Drink, since Satterfield left. Or yeah. Drink, whoever was before him. Been a couple of years.
I'm going to rank him ahead of Elko just because, like, I mean, Elko's beat Northwestern. Like, who effing cares? Like, that's not that impressive to me. And he lost to Kansas. Who also should be in the top 25, okay?
Agreed.
I put him in my poll.
Podjet top 25, yep.
I had him at 23 or 24 in my poll. I can't remember where it was.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, like, here's the thing. If Dave Doran retired at the end of the season, after we have won the ACC championship game, we've won our berth into the college football playoff. There's really nothing more he could do for us. The first call I would make is Dave Clawson. Like, I just like what he does. And I'd love to see what he does at a program that has a little bit more cachet. Second would be Jamie Chadwell. Third would be, I would have to say Clark at this point, because at least he's put together a more fun offense than the other two. Then I would do Mike Houston, and then I would do Mike Elko. Because I think you need offense to win. And, like, it's great that we've got, like, everything rolling right now with Tony Gibson, but I just can't imagine what this team would look like if it was, like, Tony Gibson's defense with Jamie Chadwell's offense.
We talked about this in the chat. If Dave hung it up, whatever, and Tony Gibson took over, which I think would be a real possibility, I would bet he would have a fun brand of offense. Like,
yeah,
similar to his defense. It would be like balls out, you know, like, we're going to, yeah, I think it would be, it'd be interesting. I don't know what it'd be, but that'd be my guess. I think he feels like that kind of coach.
Yeah, I'd just be shocked if, like, I don't think he would have a conservative offense by any means. Like, it's not his personality. And, like, I don't know, maybe behind the scenes he's, like, the same with opinion of Dave, which is, like, let's minimize the reps for the defense. Like, I get that, but you know what minimizes reps for your defense? Like, when your defense is really good and the offense can go up and score and take time off the clock and do it in a efficient manner. So, I don't know. But my problem is, like, man, I just really, I'm tired of seeing us with, like, defensive coaches as head coaches.
Yeah. You know? He just seems to be one of those guys that you don't know what his offensive philosophy would be. I think it would be kind of a wild card.
I don't know. Like, just thinking back on it, it's like, I guess I have to give Dave props. Like, he got weird with Matt Canada. He wanted, who was it? Like, Matt Wells initially? I can't remember who it was.
It was Matt Wells, correct.
Yeah.
And Rhett Lashley.
And, like, he at Northern Illinois was like, I'm going to have a running quarterback. We've got a running quarterback. We're going to keep doing this. You know, and that's the thing I've just never understood is we never recruited the guys that fit the systems that he said he wanted to run here.
Well, they tried with Bryant Sheriffs. He was that post Northern Illinois running guy, but he couldn't throw either, so and he don't wasn't that fast. Me, man.
Yeah. I mean, I would take Jacoby Brissett every day of the week because, like, he's exactly what I wanted. Like, you could have games like that UNC game, and you could have games like pretty much in every other one where he actually threw the ball. And, yeah, like, if you had paired him up a quarterback like that with any of Dave's teams except for the 2019 team, like, afterwards, I mean, like if he was there for the Bradley Chubb years and things like that, like, boy, like could have been something special. And mm-hmm. so that's just what's been weird. It's just like, I've really, MJ Morris and Jack Chambers are really the first times we've really come back to that since we abandoned the Jalen McClendon experiment.
That's true. I would probably put Jamie Chadwell top of my list. I know Clawson has done and it's been impressive at Wake. I feel like he's gotten some breaks that have gone his way.
Yeah, but sometimes, and, like, if you keep getting breaks, like, you must be good.
I get it. Yeah, I get it. I think, to me, the upside and the risk are both higher with Chadwell, and I'd go for it. And I think he would be a perfect fit with MJ Morris. So that's why I would go that route. I think he'd be really good. Can you imagine if State pulled out the slow mesh, though? Holy cow.
See, the question is whether he would do the slow mesh here. Like, I mean, he said that he developed that slow mesh because he just felt like they needed it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, that's... Shit, I wouldn't care. I'd love it. Whatever. You saw me break down the tape for Wake Forest. It'd be great. I could tell you every play that was about to happen.
Yeah. Score some points. I can tell you every play's going to happen right now, though.
Oh, well, that's true. That's true.
A lot less explosive, but... Before I get into this next question, which is unrelated to sports, what's your general feeling about this Clemson game?
Before the season, I said we are losing this game. The data backs that up. So, but you know what, man? Watching four games this season and just knowing that last year, at least at the beginning of the game, we tried to implement all the stuff we kept saying on the pod that they should be doing for that game. I'm going State. I'm feeling like this is a weird year. We've got a hurricane. We've won in a hurricane more recently than they have by a year. So yeah, I'm taking us.
Hurricane experience. I like it.
Yeah.
I will say before the year, I thought they would have a QB controversy. I think at this point, I thought they'd be working in Klubnik, and that would benefit us because it would be right about this time when they would need a quarterback to stabilize. And they haven't. DJU's been solid enough against no defenses, so we'll see what we can bring and what looks we can do to confuse them. You got to get him down. I think that Wake showed that. They were like, dry humping his leg while he was throwing passes for 2-point conversions in overtime. And it doesn't work. He's too big. He's too strong for that. I think this team will make an effort to contain Shipley like we did last year. I think that is going to be the focus. They do have two other backs, Maffa and Pace, I believe. And they're both solid.
Yeah.
But it plays into our strength, you know? I think this game's going to be weird. I think it's going to be close. I wonder how much the over-under has moved. It was 42 at one point. 44, maybe.
I wonder right if now.
Weather has dropped it. But I don't know. I don't have a bad feeling about it. I don't think we're going to magically unveil some
40 and a half
new offensive playbook. You know? But I don't think the weather is going to impede what we've been doing so far on offense.
Yeah.
That's my thought. I don't know.
I mean, here's my thought. I don't think DJ is really that much better than he was last year. Like, he's played Georgia Tech. Guess what? They just fired their coach.
Yeah.
He's played Furman. He's played Louisiana Tech. And he's been played Wake Forest, who, despite being a top 25 team, has been an abysmal defense year over year.
Right.
And he's done plenty against. And that was a game where they had to keep up shooting on offense. You know, and you like look at his numbers, it's like, okay, Georgia Tech, 19 for 32 for 210 and 1. And then Furman, 21 for 27 for 231, 2 and 1. Louisiana Tech, 17-29, 221 for 2. And then he plays Wake Forest, 26 for 41, which isn't that great, 63%. 371, 5 touchdowns. Like, yeah, that looks great. You know, but like a really good DJU should have been ripping these other teams to shreds. Right. And so I
think these teams are very similar.
Yeah. I mean, they didn't play an SEC team this year to like really see like what he can do. You know, like that's where I kind of come away from this saying like, come on, you know, he averaged 1.5 yards per carry against Georgia Tech and 3 yards per carry against Wake. Like, he hasn't played a defense like this. So that's where I kind of just sit here and say, like, it's much more balanced, I think, than people are giving. And I guess like, if they were on a neutral field, right, like right now, I guess it would be like about maybe they're like a 3-point favorite or so. The over-under is at 40.5, right? So it's not going to be a high-scoring game. So, like, who does that really favor at this point? Like, I almost like neither team, I would think. But I've seen, in theory, more clutch drives out of Devin Leary than I have out of DJU. So maybe that's what it comes down to. Maybe clutch activates for Devin.
I think these teams are very similar. Everything you just said about DJU is very much Devin Leary. Like, both of them have a top end that they have not gotten to. Right? We've seen it out of Devin more than we've seen it out of DJ. But I think both these teams are good defense, good run game. Quarterback still has some stuff to prove to me. So it should be interesting, man. I'm really excited about this game. I know a lot of people are anxious and nervous, but to me, I'm excited about it. I'm ready for this game to roll. More breaking news. Aaron Judge has hit home run 61.
Hey, guess what? I don't care.
I know. I knew you wouldn't.
That was infuriating.
Yeah, they kept cutting in.
Like, entire drives to watch someone at, like, dude, this is 2022. We have a billion ways to go see this history happen whenever we want.
Yeah.
Oh. You know what? And he's probably on roids anyways.
Yeah, they all are. Yeah, I'm sure.
Like, I'm sorry. Mark McGwire did it. Didn't Sammy Sosa do it in the same season? Like, I don't care.
Did you see a video in the pod chat? Somebody posted a video of a Clemson DB being forced to wear boxing gloves so he could stop holding. It's hilarious. So, at least we know what to expect this week. He's going to get punched.
Put Ant Smith on
that guy. Yeah,
on 20
that
guy. Or 22, whichever it was. Oh my God. Just put him in. Just let him run with go rats. Just be like, hey, Ant, I don't even know if we're even going to throw the ball at you, but just keep running down there and get that holding at least. That was insane.
All right. Here's a life question for you before we get out of here. We haven't had one of these in a while. Mahesh has been slacking. What have you learned in evaluating job opportunities? What is the best advice you have for evaluating who you would be working with, boss, company, or I think you have your own business you can speak of from your perspective? Oh, who you'd be working with. So what have you learned in evaluating job opportunities? Interesting question. I was thinking about this one last couple
days. Yeah, it's a tough one for me because I've been with my company for almost 14 years.
Yeah.
But let's see. Why don't you go first? I'll think back on this for a second.
I think what is best advice you have for evaluating who you'd be working with? To me, it's something I deal with a lot with, you know, hiring contractors or hiring employees. I want somebody who's going to be able to think for themselves, right? I want somebody who I don't have to babysit as an employee, right? That's kind of what I look for. Somebody who can get their work done. And, you know, as on the converse, as a boss, I want somebody who's not going to, would not hover over me. I left the corporate world after being in it for a very short period of time because I had one of those bosses who wouldn't let you question him, wouldn't let you do anything. And I was like, F this, I can do this better on my own. I went and did it on my own. That's what I've been doing ever since. You know, for me, it's always hard to evaluate like people during job interviews or evaluate a company, you know, beforehand, you know, so it's honestly, it's kind of a crapshoot. I'm not sure I have a great answer for that. Like, to me, I'm like, look at what they do and what their values are. I know people will say, like, our values are this, but do their actions meet up with it? One of the companies that I like to follow is Basecamp. It's a project management tool. They created email and some other things. And Jason Fried is one of the founders. And I really like his philosophy on things, right? And they took back, for example, one of the things they did for a while there, they were giving you money for like gym memberships and these things and time and all that stuff and all these perks. And then at one time, they just took them all back. And you're like, at first, I go, damn, why would they do that? And he's like, well, I want to interfere less in your lives. Do whatever you want. I'll give you more money. So they raised everybody's salary to compensate for losing those perks. And basically said, I'm not going to interfere in your daily life. Do the things that are interesting to you. Do the thing. Here's what we write. You know, here's this kind of stuff that we do. We want you to have a healthy life. We want you to have a good balance. To me, that, you know, somebody who does something like that, that speaks a lot to me. I don't want somebody who's going to, you know, force certain things on you or whatever. I thought that was, to me, when that happened, I was like, oh man, that's really, I really respect that as a, you know, as a potential boss or employer or whoever. Like, I thought that was a really bold move. Like, to be nowadays, everybody wants you to buy in. You got to be a team player, right? You got to be in on all this stuff. And I think it's the opposite. To me, I tell my guys, get your work done. I don't care what you do, when you do it. If it gets done on schedule, it gets done right, then, you know, more power to you. Like, you can do it in 4 hours. You don't have to work 40 hours. Like, that to me is kind of what I would look for in return from a boss, is like that kind of mutual respect that I'm not going to hover over you. I don't need to impart my morals and beliefs and all this other stuff. Like, that's not me, right? And that's what I would look for, right? Just that, something I can kind of relate to, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's kind of a long-winded answer that I'm not sure, but
yeah. I would say, from an employee perspective, like, I've been blessed. I've been with our company for almost 14 years, and I would say I'd gladly work under any manager I've had. I was in a leadership program for over 2 years, and I had a ton of roles. I think I ended up having 8 or 9 jobs inside of what was supposed to be 4 rotations. So I got a lot of exposure that way. I would say, for managers, you know, look for someone that kind of manages to, I don't know how to say this. Like, I was going to say, like, your love languages, but like, you really need someone that manages in a way that corresponds to how you need to be managed or coached. So if you're someone that really needs that kind of oversight, unlike what Evan was saying, right, that needs that kind of micromanaging, like, find someone that is a micromanager. If you're someone that, you know, you need a boss that you can vent to, and they will listen to it and then give you constructive feedback, or just let you understand that you were just getting something off your chest and let you keep going and be self-sufficient, like, find someone that allows that in their team. I think it's really important. Like, all the managers that I've had were really supportive for me in allowing me to kind of own the job and responsibilities how I wanted to own them, and would let me chase down special projects and let me get kind of lost in the weeds when it was appropriate. So I've gotten really lucky there. And I would say, as far as like coworkers or trying to find a team that you want to work on, like, interview the team as well. So like, when you're there meeting with the manager and going through the interview, be like, hey, I'd like to go like talk with folks on the team and like, see what kind of people they are, see if they're kind of a group of, you know, if they're inclusive or not. And whether that matters to you. So like, you really need to understand yourself and what you want. Like, my current team is, I'm the youngest person on the team and I'm 37. Right. And so, but all of the guys on our team are like pretty fun and enjoyable to be around, but when you really need some guidance, like they have years and years of experience. And so like, I really appreciate that from my view, because if I need something, I can go to them and I know it's not them, you know, shooting off the hip about something. Like they've seen it. They've been in this organization or this industry for a long time. So like, understand what's important to you and like, be patient. Like if you go to an interview and you meet the hiring manager, or if the hiring manager is your actual manager and they like, you're not going to jive with them. Like it's okay to pass on an opportunity. Same thing. If like, it's a team full of vipers that you're going to be working with and that's not a good environment for you. Like don't go work there. So like try to be a little picky, but like when you're getting interviewed, like make sure you're interviewing the person interviewing you as well and interviewing their team and understanding like who you're going to really be around. And you know, like when you're talking to like the team, if you get that opportunity, you should be like, hey, like how has the manager like fought for you guys in the past? Have there been any things like coming down from upper management that they protected you from or supported you during? Like, what's it like when something goes wrong? Like, how do they treat if you miss a number, miss a quote, like whatever? It'll be a little different probably for Mahesh because he's going to be in a completely different field. Like, and
this is from somebody else.
Psychopaths, basically. Yeah. But yeah, that's kind of how I would approach it. Like if I was looking for a job now, I have to be careful because my boss listens to these pods.
That's getting ready to say, you should be saying nice stuff about your boss.
Well, no, I mean, my boss has been my mentor for almost 14 years. So like we have a we have a very unique, relationship already. And even then, like, you know, he has got to really push really hard to get through to me at a lot of times. but like, if it was me, if I was looking around, like those are the criteria I would be using. Like I have a really good team. I've been blessed with a really good team at work, and I wouldn't leave to go to an environment where I'm like, oh man, I'm working with a bunch of dildos. Like, you know, so just take your time. I know that's hard to hear for a lot of people, but you know, if you can try to be picky, it'll be worth it.
Yeah. It's an interesting question, man. Like it's, I don't know. Like I'm in a different stage of my life where I don't have time for bullshit, right? And like I did some work for a company recently, and it was in like under a white label, and one of their people sent me, put this in your email signature. I was like, no, I'm not going to do this. And then, you know, it's like, well, you need to update this and then add your pronouns to your bio. I'm like, no, I'm not going to do this. Like, and like, those are things that are like red flags to me. I get you want everybody to buy into your culture, and that's kind of what they were forcing. But at the same time, that's not how I define myself. I'm not doing this because you want me to. Right. And I never did it. And then I was like, all right, this is not going to work for us. Like, it should have been a red flag for me from the beginning because they worked very much the same way. And it was one of those places. And I know we've all been at them or I've seen them where it's, yay, we love this place. We love Company X. We, you know, this is our life, blah, blah, blah. Like, and then that's not me, man. You know, when I'm out the door, I'm out the door. I don't want to hear your work stuff. I want to hang out with my kids. I want to play golf. I want to do these other things. Like I'm not being defined by a company. So I know a lot of people are, and they like that camaraderie, so to speak, but that's not me. So I'm in a little bit different place. I look for people who are going to be real. If I was going to a job interview right now, I would probably look at social media and see what other people are saying or doing around that place, like other employees. You know, they all have their socials out there and whatnot, and just try to understand like who would I be working with, and are they, you know, do I jive with them? because I don't have time for people's nonsense and and how they if they don't communicate well, you know, those are kind of things that I look for. Like, you should be able to write me a 3-sentence email rather than scheduling a meeting for 30 minutes, like stuff like that. Like, can you communicate? Do these people talk? Or is it, you know, kind of disingenuous? And you can get that vibe, I think, really quickly.
Definitely.
So, yeah.
Yeah. And you hit on a thing that was always a pet peeve for me was, like the email signature police is super frustrating. We've seen it at times a lot with my company because, we've like constantly changed our names over time. People are like, well, you got to change your signature. You can't say that. I'm like, who cares, man? Like, this name's going to change in 6 months. It's not going to impact anything. My customers don't care. Like, I remember one time I picked up a phone call and I just said, hello, instead of blah, 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 this is Will. And this person like chewed me out for like 30 seconds. And I was like, listen, bud, like, you better have something important you're about to ask me because I'm about to hang this up. Like, I don't care.
Yeah.
Like, you caught me in the middle of something and I'm saying hello and you're our company phone number. I know you're one of our people. So you meant to call me. What's up?
Yeah.
And, you know, if you get somewhere and they're giving you that vibe, like, I'd bounce out of that. It's funny you say that thing about the pronouns thing. It's like, if you want to put that in your thing, more power to you. But like, I really hate like forced things of that nature. It's like, if it's important to you, say it, but don't force us all to say something if we don't really care. Like, I don't care. I don't care what you call me. Like,
it's very rah-rah, and I just have never, I'm not into that.
Yeah. The one thing too, you kind of said, like, I don't know if you said it was like looking out for like disingenuous stuff, but like those social media presences where everyone is like talking with a marketing focus. Like,
yeah.
That's a red flag to me. Like, yeah. So that's a good thing. Yeah. If everyone like will keep it real with you, and if you find a good team and good managers, like they'll keep it real with you.
Yeah.
And like the thing too is like when you're interviewing, like do some research on that company too. Like, I know it sounds boring, but go read some 10-Ks and public filings and like understand like where you're going to go work. And then when you're in the middle of those interviews, just be like, you know, I was reading through this financial statement and I'm kind of curious, like, why is this project important to this company? And like they'll one, think you're sharper than most candidates right away. And two, if they have something to say about it and it's actually an interesting conversation that comes out of it, it'll be good for you to kind of see what they say. So, you know, do a little research before you go into those interviews.
Yep.
It'll pay off.
Yeah. If you're not in a position to be picky, then at least understand what you're getting into and keep your options open. Like, I mean,
yeah. Are the benefits good? Are they going to pay you? Like, is it just a job? Then it's okay for it to just be just a job. And I'm with you, man. Like, after a certain time, an hour, I guess I can't really talk because it was like 7:30 when you texted me and you were like, do you want a podcast? And I was like, I'm just finishing with work. But like being able to turn off and go have your life and then turn back on in the morning and turn back on after the weekend to me is really important. I'm always there if my customer needs me, but at the same time, like I'm not gonna read emails over the weekend, not until Sunday. Like, I'm not doing it.
Yeah. One of the things I've done back in the day and I stuck with it is I blocked my Fridays from meetings, and it allows me to do work or play or do whatever I want. But it just, I don't get people booking meetings at the last minute before the weekend when it's not going to be productive. And I got to think about it all weekend. Honestly, it's really saved my sanity. And I suggested to more people, like, at least like block maybe more hours. If you need me to schedule a meeting with you, I will send you a meeting invite so you can do that. But it's one of those things that has helped tremendously. And it also forces me to do more work on Thursday. So,
well, I'm going to say though, man, like sometimes that Friday afternoon meeting is like truly an emergency and it drives me nuts.
Yeah.
Because everyone does that. And I'm just like, oh, I don't want to be that guy. But it's 4:00 on Friday, and I really actually do need to talk to you. One of the things I will just say, like a general good practice to that point about blocking meetings is we block off I think it's like 1 to 4 o'clock on Wednesdays. Mm-hmm. And it's like basically, unless it's customer focused or your team really needs to have a meeting, like that's your time to just get stuff done.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people should implement that.
I agree. All right. That's our life advice section. I always liked it. We haven't gotten those questions in a while. So thanks for bringing that one back up. As an old guy, I like to impart my wisdom on people who ask questions.
Or and also fully max out your 401k.
Yeah.
And,
yeah. Anyway, as always, thanks for listening. Enjoy the week of being top 10 team. Enjoy the excitement of this game and what it means to us and being in the spotlight. Let's try not to be skeptical. Let's try not to be negative and just enjoy it and hope for the best. That's kind of where I'm going to leave this week. And I'm going to go into Saturday, hopefully win, not too anxious, just ready to watch a good game. And I hope the team is that same attitude.
Yeah. And ignore the fact that for the first hour and 15 minutes of this podcast, we were pretty negative.
Yeah. No. On game. Well, we were just picking them. I mean, that's what we're supposed to do, right? Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, as always, go Pack.
Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves.